Hey guys, here we are. I'll give you guys a couple minutes to, or a minute or so to get started, to get logged on, if people want to join. But basically I'm doing a short live video now to try to go over some things about the virtual debate. A lot of people had questions about how this is going to work. Honestly, so do I. But we really just, we have to do our very best to make it work. If you're thinking, this doesn't seem like a perfect system, yeah, nothing is a perfect system right now, right? But we're doing our very best to accommodate that, and I'm really happy with, thankfully, the resources that we have available, it seems like most students are getting logged on and are getting connected with Google Classroom. Hey guys, and that's wonderful. How everything is going to work in general is very up in the air, but in terms of the debate, I wanted to make sure that we started that right away. So, in particular, because at least the last I was told, the marking period is still supposed to end on March 27th, and obviously we were supposed to do this debate this week. We should, if we were in school, we would be done with debates by now, theoretically, right? So, in terms of those grades, some people had asked, why don't we just not do debates, or why don't we make them count towards the new marking period? You really don't want to do that, because, I'm obviously going to try to be as flexible and thoughtful in terms of everything that's going on when doing your grades, but school has to continue. Things need to go on, as you know, and move forward to the best that we can. And so, as much as we want to be understanding, and I want to be as understanding and flexible as I can, we all have to take it seriously, and we all have to be structured, and we all have to be, treat this like school, because it is school, and you know, we have to make sure that everyone is getting the education that they're entitled to and that they deserve. So, you know, I hope that all of us together, students and teachers, can really reinforce this feeling and the understanding that, look, we're in a difficult situation, but we're in it together, and we need to make sure that the education is moving forward and that you guys continue to be educated. And that's something that we as teachers need to do and do our best to make happen, but it's also something that we need the buy-in from you. We need you guys to support us and support each other, support your fellow students in recognizing that this is for real, this is school. And, you know, we still want to get things done, but we got to cooperate, and it's going to be a little bit trickier because we don't see each other in person. So we really need to make sure that we support each other and we're, you know, looking out for each other during this whole process that maybe for a while. Excuse me as I eat some frozen grapes. Hey guys, hey everybody. So as everybody is kind of getting on, hopefully, we wanted to talk specifically about the debate. I'm not going to do a live for like an hour or something, God willing, hopefully. I'll try to make this brief, but try to address some of your questions. First of all, especially if you're watching this later on, I'll do my best to make sure that it saves this time. If you're watching this later, before you listen and before you ask a million questions, guys, make sure you've read the directions that are posted on Google Classroom. On Google Classroom, I wrote very detailed directions. I know sometimes people give me a hard time and say, Mister, why are you making this direction so long? Because I know all the questions you're going to start asking me, and I'm trying to address them before you ask them. If I don't make them detailed, everyone would ask more questions. So I've actually added on the directions. At the bottom of the directions, there's a frequently asked questions category, and since I can update the Google Doc, which is amazing, I can update it, and it's updates for you as well on your end. As people ask me questions and big questions come up, I'm adding them on there. So make sure you go all the way to the bottom and you read those as well. But make sure you read the directions, because I try to be as detailed and clear as possible. So just to kind of go over it in general, very simply, the basic idea is, look, we can't meet in person, but we had a debate scheduled. Yes, the debate is going in for this marking period, guys. So that means that the debate has to be done. I put the due date as next Wednesday, which is March 25th. The marking period is supposed to end on March 27th. when my grades are officially due. I'm not sure the exact date, but it's probably a couple days after that. That means I need to make sure everybody gets their debates in and sent by Wednesday. I would strongly, strongly hope that as many groups as possible can get their debates sent to me well before that. If you can take care of it on Saturday and you can send it to me and you can put it in through the system that I've created, that would be wonderful. And it would be a real help to me as well, so that I'm not trying to grade a million debates, or the bigger concern is not even grading the debates. The bigger concern for me is trying to hunt everybody down. And I know, and I'll address that in a few minutes, but I know we've had issues with people having trouble getting in contact with their group members. And that's the real thing. I understand that. I'm going to do my best to support you guys in that and help you get in touch with your group members. So hopefully we can get everybody together as much as possible. Alright, so let me just briefly explain how does this work. Basically, we think of it as a video project in which you do your debate. If there wasn't a coronavirus pandemic going on, but we were doing video debates, then probably, you know, I would tell you guys to meet up after school or whatever in the hallway and film the debate, right? But that would probably not be great anyway. But the point is, we obviously can't be physically together. So what do? It's exactly the same structure, more or less, as the regular debate. You simply have your phone, and you put it somewhere, stand it up, and film your part of the debate. So just like you would do in class to everybody, you do to the phone and your device, and you introduce yourself for your construction. Hi, my name is so-and-so. Our debate question is this. You have 1 to 2 minutes to speak. You do your debate. You do your arguments. You do your sources. You do all that stuff. 2 minutes. It's done. It's filmed. Same thing with rebuttals. If you read the directions, you'll see that it's a little bit more detailed than that. But basically, the moderators will pre-film their intros, their transitions. Thank you very much, affirmative one. Affirmative two, you may now begin. You have 2 minutes starting now. They'll film those things in advance, each piece that they know would be there. And they will also film their conclusion. All right, well, that concludes our debate. Thank you, everyone, for being here and for watching, and please clap for, you know, maybe not clap, you're not going to be able to hear, but thank you all for watching, and thank you for participating in the debate. For the debaters, you will film your construction, meaning the main part, the 2 minute part, and then within your group, so I would recommend making a group chat, either on Instagram or on text or however, as long as it's a group chat where you can send and download videos from each other. You send them out in the group. Everybody now has access to each other's constructions, right? The next step is, before you move on, the moderator is going to do a lot. The moderator or moderators is going to give some feedback to the debaters. I definitely would encourage everyone to give feedback from the group to the debaters and say, hey, that was really good. This was maybe something you want to fix, you want to work on. You actually went a little bit over your time. You need to trim it down. And that will be an opportunity for, like, basically your first recording of your constructions, like your first draft. You send it out to your group, they give you feedback, and you have the option to re-record it. If you're like, I'm happy with how it went, I don't need to re-record it, I'm sure for you guys, you will, you know, on your own, you can re-record it as many times as you want until you have it just the way you like it. And then if based on the feedback from each other, you decide, I want to do it again, you can do that, right? So once you've settled on that, you've sent your second version, that's your final construction. Now the next step is the moderators are going to listen to what you said, and they're going to give you a question. So they're going to record themselves asking the question, and they'll say, all right, thank you very much, Muhammad, for your construction. I have a follow-up question. What is that follow-up question? It's similar to the questions we usually prepare as moderators for the debaters. But instead of interrupting or jumping in during the debate time, as you might do in a debate in class, if the person gets stuck, to help them move forward, this is going to be a question that comes after the time has already elapsed, and you should be listening to what they're saying, and based on what they said, ask them a question. Now you can and you are required to prepare 3 potential questions, but if those questions are not relevant or you think of a better question based on what they said, then you ask it. These are not rebuttals from the moderator. They're not challenging you. They're not trying to throw you off or catch you. But but they are either neutral or supportive, right? So if somebody mentioned something at the end, but they had to be very brief about it because they didn't have time, they could say, you know, you mentioned this idea. What did you mean by that? Or how could that apply? Or how does that relate to the topic? Especially if there's something that they kind of maybe need to be more clear about how it relates to their topic. If there's a term they use that you want to have them define, there's not one right way to do it. A lot of different things you could ask them, but the moderator has to ask each debater one follow-up question to help them get more out of the debate, and then the debater who is being asked will have to send a video in response to that question of no more than 30 seconds. It can really be 10 seconds, that's fine if it's just something that you can answer that quickly, but no more than 30 seconds. That is the follow-up question. You'll do that, the moderators will do that for each of the four debaters, or six in some cases, and then after everybody has responded and sent their follow-up question answers, then the next step is the rebuttals, and those are the only ones that have to be in order. So like for constructions, it's like when you're done with it, send it to the group, you know, let everybody see it, get your feedback. You can always resend it for the follow-up questions as well. The moderator can just send out all the follow-up questions at once, you know, record each one, send them out, everybody can respond to their respective questions. But for the rebuttals, it's important that they go in order. So you get to decide who's first or second in terms of affirmative or negative. But it has to go affirmative 1, then negative 1, then affirmative 2, then negative 2. And if there's 3, then affirmative 3, and then negative 3 for rebuttals. The reason why it's important for the rebuttals is you need to make sure that you have the opportunity not just to respond to what they said in their construction and follow-up questions, but you have a chance to respond to them in the rebuttal, so the rebuttal can kind of be that back and forth, right? So affirmative 1 will give their rebuttal, 30 seconds to 1 minute, then you'll send that out to the group. Everybody watches it, then negative 1 will go, and considering what that person said in their rebuttal, they might want to respond directly to that, or to something that was mentioned earlier, and so on. Then affirmative 2 will go and have the opportunity to possibly respond to negative 1 or respond to something earlier, and it can have that back and forth part to it. If you guys want to ask a question, if you could do it through the questions rather than just in the chat, because I might miss it if it's in the chat. And so once you've filmed all those parts, somebody in the group, hopefully the moderator, ideally, will take all those videos, those final versions of the videos, and edit them together, and then you will post it. I'm encouraging you guys to post it through YouTube, but post it as an unlisted video. So you're not posting it publicly where somebody can go to the channel and look at it, right? You're using YouTube as a way to upload a video, but it's not being posted to YouTube. It's called unlisted, which means only somebody with the link can see it. So you just don't give anyone the link, and then no one can see it. You send me the link. There's a form, a Google form that I put on Google Classrooms. You use that, and you send me that link, and then I can watch your debate, the final version of it. I would encourage you, whoever's doing the editing, to send it out to the group first. They can give you their approval, say, yep, it looks good, everything looks like it's right, it's accurate, and then you can send it to me. So that's how it works. Now let's look at some of the questions that you guys had about how the debate. Somebody said, can we add cool music in the editing for extra credit? Yeah, you can definitely add cool music. You can add any kind of stuff like that, like music and titles and effects, as long as it doesn't take away from the debate, as long as it doesn't distract from the debate. Like, for example, music probably should not be playing while someone's talking. It might make it hard for me to hear them, or it might influence the way that their debate comes across. But intro music, outro music, totally fine if you want to do some, if you're good at that, and if it's something that you're excited about, you can definitely jazz it up with some effects like that. Whether you'll get extra credit, I don't know, but maybe. Good, in terms of the overall production of it. It might influence me indirectly. If I think it's a really high-quality debate, I might be more influenced, I might be more convinced of your arguments, or I might feel more inspired by your presentation if you do that. So, certainly not a requirement, but can't hurt. Let's see. Do we have to look at the camera? This is a question that I already answered in the FAQ. Yes, you do. It's just like a debate. You know, I need to, it's just like a debate in person. In the debate, I would expect you guys to be looking at the audience. In this case, the audience is the camera. So you need to look at the camera. That shows that you're prepared. That shows that you are, your presentation is strong. So just like anything else, practice. The nice thing here is you can literally record it a bunch of times and keep doing it till you get it right. You can watch yourself. You can look at what you did and, you know, where you want to fix things, and you can re-record it and then send it to your group when you feel like it's ready. But yes, you should be looking at the camera. You should be using as much emotion, and you can use your hand gestures. One thing that I had said also is make sure before you start filming anything that you and your whole group agree. Is it going to be this way or is it going to be this way, right? Is it going to be vertical portrait mode or is it going to be horizontal landscape mode? Because it's going to look really bad if some of them are like this, some of them are like this, and it keeps changing. Either one is fine. I tend to be more into the landscape mode. I think it looks better, more professional, but if you are used to doing it like this, I'm totally fine with that. So it's whichever one. Just make sure everyone, it's going to be diagonal. Let me know how that works out. How are we going to do rebuttals if it's going to be virtual? So I did already explain this just before, but to clarify, like I said, every other part of it, constructions, the follow-up questions, the responses to the follow-up questions can be done. Whoever wants to do it first, whoever sends it out first, doesn't matter. But when it comes to the rebuttals, you don't start sending those until everything else is done. Everything else has been sent into the group. You see, and then whoever's a moderator in the group should say, all right, guys, we're ready to start doing rebuttals. It has to be in order. The affirmative one goes first. They send their video. Everybody gets a chance to see it. And then you wait for negative one to be able to send their video, right? Remember, this doesn't all have to happen like in an hour. You don't have to all be on your phones at the same time or your device at the same time waiting for everyone to respond. You can start tonight, tomorrow. I would strongly urge that everyone at least have their constructions filmed and done, and the moderators have their intro, outro, and transitions filmed and done by tomorrow. That way, if you're having trouble getting a hold of somebody or you are, whatever other issues there may be, you did your part so far. So that way we can figure out the rebuttals afterward. And then it'll be easier if you at least have some things. But the rebuttals can have to be one, then the other, then the other, then the other. It could be an hour later. Oh, somebody's busy. All right, I'll send you my rebuttal, you know, by 11:30. Okay, cool. Oh, I'm not going to be around by then. I'll send you my rebuttal at 2. All right, whatever you guys want to do, you can make it work. Let's see. More questions. I don't know what this means. How is the formatting of the debate going to work? I think I already answered this, and I think you, the student had said that she had read the directions and kind of clarified it, but hopefully what I said in the beginning clarified this as well. You know what? Go for it. If you think that it would help. So somebody asked me earlier today also about how we should dress. You have to be in dress code. You don't have to be in dress code, but professional dress, I think definitely helps with your persuasiveness and your authority and making it seem that you are, coming across very professionally. But if you think that a fun hat would increase your pathos and would increase your emotional connection with the audience and that it would draw people into what you're saying, as long as it's appropriate, you can wear a funny hat. When do we really go back? I don't know. They said April 20th at the earliest, but that's in no way guaranteed. It's a pandemic, guys. This is not a small thing. This is not a joke. This is very serious. This is clearly going to change the shape of our country and our lives. for a long time to come. And we can talk more about that too. We'll definitely take some time over the next couple weeks to, you know, have these kind of conversations. Are we really going back on the 20th? We'll see. When are we going back? I don't know. What if we don't have a working camera? Okay, so then I'm getting a few different questions to like in this category of questions. What if I can't do it for some reason? Well, here's the thing, guys. Like I said at the beginning of this live, this is new for everyone. And obviously, as teachers, we want to be as understanding and as flexible as we can to make this work and understand that not everyone is in the same situation in terms of technology, in terms of, God forbid, health, if anybody gets sick with this or family members do. Obviously, that's going to interrupt, that's going to disrupt education. And, you know, there's only so much we can do. We have to just do our best. On the other hand, it's really important for us as teachers, and it's really important for you guys as students, that we make sure we take this seriously. And by this, I mean this online education. School is continuing, and it has to continue. Your education is essential. Your education is so important. And we need to make sure that there's buy-in. You guys need to make sure for each other that there's buy-in. What I mean by that is we need to make sure that everybody understands this is school. School's going. We're back. We're just not back in person, right? We're back virtually. And we are doing our best to make that work for you guys. So we need you to get on board with that as much as possible. So a number of people have asked me things like, what if I can't do the debate? Or what if, you know, whatever it is. It depends on what you mean by can't. If you literally cannot because of a serious health issue or something like that, that it's absolutely unavoidable, then you reach out to me directly and we'll have a conversation about that in you know, person by person. But for this debate to function, we need everyone to take it seriously, and you can't just say, I don't really feel like it, I'm not into it, is there something else I can do? No, the same way that in class you couldn't just say, I don't really want to debate, let's do something else. That's not how it works. This is the number one assessment of the entire marking period. It is the biggest grade. It's worth 30% of your average, and that is still the case, even though it's virtual. So I need you guys to take this as seriously as possible. Somebody just said we should do the debate when we come back. When is that? Next year? We don't know. We're doing the marking period ends on May 27th. We need to do this before May 27th. It needs to be graded before May 27th because this is worth 30% of your average. And guys, remember, debates are usually the things that really boost your grade, right? All the other components of your grade, they all work together. You have your test category 30%, you have your debates 30%, you have your projects and essays 25%, you have your homeworks and classworks 15%. That percentage system is balanced out for a reason, right? They're meant to complement each other and each play a role in what your grade is. So if your grade is low, and you're saying, Miss, I'm worried about my grade, then you need to really take this debate seriously, because it's okay. We're all doing our best. We need to really take this debate seriously. And I mentioned it because you're not the only person who has said things like that, so that's why. So if you literally don't have a camera, like your phone is broken or something like that, you know, there's been a real attempt to get technology to everyone. Obviously, we know not everyone has the same technology, but we need to do our best to you know, make sure everyone gets access to that technology, and the school is doing what it can to get that to people. If you specifically have a technological issue where you can't get access, reach out to me, either here or on Google Classroom or by email, and we'll address that. But everybody needs to be participating in this debate. In the same way that you would in class, you need to do that. In terms of an essay, some people asked, about an essay. Hold on one second. Let me see if I have it in here. Here we go. Where's the debate essay? There's no debate essay for you, right? Just like in class, you can't... Guys, first of all, the comments in here, I'm going to block people, and you're not going to be able to do... If you don't stop with these comments, some of these inappropriate comments, I'm not going to be able to do any live videos anymore. I'm going to ban you from this entire account. And you won't be able to participate in anything, and I'm not going to try to get you back in, and you're going to miss out on any video stuff and be not going to be able to learn properly. So, enough. I didn't think I'd be doing classroom management from home, but here I am. So, if somebody has a health emergency, if somebody has, you know, in terms of technology, just completely incapable of doing it, then that person would be, you know, we have to do an alternate assignment for that person, but the group would have to go on without them. I don't know what you mean. Are we still, oh, the essay is something different. Well, that we're going to put on the back burner. That's going to have to wait till the new marking period. DBQ essay for AP and the enduring issues essay for global. This person is kind of like banned them right now. Okay, bye. The person's gone. Okay, cool. An alternate assignment is not something that's optional. It's something that is there for people who have a serious issue, have a serious situation where they absolutely cannot do it. That's not just for, like, if you'd like to.